Order. It's now time for questions to the Minister for Communities, and we will start with listed questions. I call Mrs. Sandra Overend. Mrs. Overend.
Thank you. Question one, please.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. A revised Northern Ireland Local Government Code of Conduct for councillors was issued for consultation on the 21st of December 2016. Together with the report of the Code of Conduct Review Working Group, the consultation will run until the 28th of February 2017, and a synopsis of the responses to the consultation, along with any response from my department, will be forwarded to the Committee for Communities for consideration prior to publication. Any amendment to the current Code of Conduct for councillors will require the approval of the Assembly before it may come into operation. And Deputy Speaker, just for the record, to declare my dad as a councillor.
Mrs. Overend, supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister. Does the Minister agree with me that a revised Code of Conduct for councillors must draw a distinction between strict regulations for councillors involved in quasi-judicial decisions, such as members of planning committees, and areas where councillors must have more freedom to represent the concerns of their electorate?
Minister. Deputy Speaker, I do, and the consultation reflects that. But clearly, where there are quasi-judicial decisions to be taken, for example, around planning or to do with licensing, to give those two examples, then it's important that the Code of Conduct, as currently applies, would continue to be that way. But obviously, local government, reflective of all the political parties, raised issues around other aspects of council activities and councillors and committees and decision-making processes, and felt that the current Code of Conduct presented challenges around that. So I suppose this is a two-pronged approach, one very clearly having the quasi-judicial aspect, and then the consultation that reflects the changes to do with the other aspects of the council.
Thank you. Call David Ford.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Building on Mrs. Overend's supplementary question, there certainly have been questions raised in the past, including when this Assembly passed the Local Government Act, about the issue of transparency of political donations, particularly in the context of planning decisions. Would the Minister agree that it's time that large donations were made public?
Yeah, obviously that's something that our party's been very clear on, and donations will be made public whenever the NIO decide that they're going to release it. So that decision's in the hands of the Secretary of State. But I think very much so, whenever the time is right to do that, then there shouldn't be anyone hiding away from making that information available to the public.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, why was Part 3 principles reviewed?
Well, Deputy Speaker, the principles in the current Councillors' Code mirror those which were set out in the previous MLA Code, which was in force at the time when the Councillors' Code was being drafted. When the Councillors' Code excuse me, was brought before the Assembly for consideration, the MLA Code was being reviewed, and during the Assembly debate on the motion to approve the Councillors' Code, the then Minister for the Environment had indicated that following the outcome of the ongoing review of the MLA Code, consideration would be given as to whether any changes to the Councillors' Code would be needed. The review working group considered the changes to the principles in the revised MLA Code. The principles in the proposed Councillors' Code, which is currently being consulted on, mirror those in the revised MLA Code. The proposed Councillors' Code also frames the principles as aspirational and not enforceable on their own, which is in line with the MLA Code.
Thank you. We move on. I call Mr. Eamon McCann.
Thank
you, Deputy Speaker. I know the member has raised this issue before in a written question, and as I advised him in earlier reply to that question, the only discussions the Housing Executive has had with the Strategic Investment Board about the transfer of ownership of buildings have been in connection with the Department of Finance's reform of property management programme. The Strategic Investment Board is supporting the Department of Finance with the delivery of the Reform of Property Management Programme. This programme has been established to improve the management and reduce the cost of the central government office estate. Changes might include exiting leases, developing more efficient office accommodation, and transferring ownership of property to the control of the Department of Finance. The Housing Executive has kept my department informed of the discussions that have been held.
Mr. McCann.
So as the Minister notes, I have raised this question a number of times in my
a stint here, but the question I'm asking here goes to the heart of the matters which have risen in relation to questions and letters that I've sent to various people involved, and it's simply this. I mean, when I read the minutes of the meetings of the Strategic Investment Board, I read discussions about the housing executive stock sort of, and whether it should be transferred in bundles of 1,000 or 2,000. What I'm asking you, Minister, is very simple. Where, at what point and in what form is there democratic scrutiny of the process by which housing executive stock is being transferred?
Minister.
Deputy Speaker, Mr McCann is very ably showing that where democratic accountability is by raising these questions. But in respect to discussions between the Housing Executive and Strategic Investment Board around transfer of residential properties, there haven't been those discussions with the SIB when it comes to the Housing Executive. It's been in the context that I outlined in my original answer, but in respect of housing transfer stock, yes, the Housing Executive has undertaken to transfer 2,000 of its homes to housing associations, and that's to deliver £100 million of investment. That the small-scale voluntary stock transfer programme is not part of the DOF reform of property management programme, and no residential properties owned by the Housing Executive will transfer to housing associations without the agreement of any tenants.
Jenny Palmer.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister to outline what discussions he's had with senior members and of staff of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive in relation to the future of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive and where that is?
Well, the discussions that I would have had will have been purely with the Chief Executive. However, that's been very limited because obviously it was a matter for the executive, first of all, to look at in terms of whatever future changes or not that there would be with the housing executive. And there had been no agreement reached in respect of what would happen to the housing executive. So it would only be once the executive, and obviously through committee consultation, scrutiny, the assembly, whenever there was a clear pathway identified in respect of the housing executive, well, obviously you would then need to be engaging with the housing executive as to what shape that would take or whether there would be any change at all. So there hasn't been discussions of that nature with the housing executive at that level.
Mark Durkin.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answers thus far. I think I heard some semblance of an assurance there, but I'd like to draw a wee bit more from the Minister maybe. What assurance can the Minister give, or would the Minister give, to Northern Ireland Housing Executive tenants in, say, for example, the Roswell Street area of my constituency, that ownership of their homes will not be transferred to a housing association against their wishes?
Minister.
And I suppose that allows me to elaborate a little bit on what Mr McCann said about the democratic accountability. In any transfer of stock from the housing executive to a housing association, that requires the agreement of tenants. There is a ballot that takes place. And that would be the same that, say, for example, should the housing executive at any point in the future decide that it would be become a housing association, or the other options that would need to be looked at, in terms of what other people have put forward, that housing executive stock could go to other housing associations, and there's been thinking around some of that aspect of it. But say, for example, if the housing executive, to free it up, to allow it to borrow, to build houses, was to become some kind of housing association model, and there's various ways to do that, the tenants would have to vote for that, and that would include every single tenant that currently exists for the housing executive, and if they didn't agree to it, it couldn't happen.
Thank you. Mr. Jerry Mullen is not in his place. I call Mr. Justin McNulty.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Question number four, please.
Minister.
Well, Deputy Speaker, I'm acutely aware of the issues in relation to housing need and high demand for social housing in Northern Ireland. That is why, in the programme for government, I am committing to building 9,600 new social homes here by 2021. As the member may know, new social housing is delivered with substantial government grants to housing associations. In the current financial year, my department has made £106 million of capital funding available to deliver a target of 1,600 new social homes. My officials will continue to liaise with the Department of Finance to secure the necessary capital funding for the rest of the programme for government period through the normal budgetary process. The Home Building Fund, to which this funding has been allocated, in England does not directly apply in Northern Ireland. The UK Government's Home Building Fund is loan funding for private sector organisations to build homes for rent or sale. Barnett consequentials are not ring-fenced when they are made available to Northern Ireland. The Executive is responsible for deciding how best to allocate the available capital budget, including any additional funding through Barnett consequentials that are based on local needs and priorities.
Thank you, Mr McNulty. Supplementary.
Thank you. Thank the Minister for his answer thus far. Can I ask the Minister, has he made a commitment to use these funds to build over and above the 9,600 houses he has agreed to build in this mandate?
Well, obviously, where there are Barnett consequentials that flow, as I've indicated, that will be for the Executive to decide how that money should be spent. Certainly in the past, where there's been Barnett consequentials as a result of housing changes in England that the Executive has got money from, then certainly that money has been used in the past to go into housing. But ultimately, it is at the discretion of the Executive, whoever makes up that Executive after the election, to decide how Barnett consequential monies is ultimately spent.
I call Carla Lockhart.
Mr Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for his answers thus far. Can I ask the Minister, has the Department previously received money for housing through the Barnett consequentials, and if so, how has this money been allocated?
Deputy Speaker, some examples of that are Barnett consequentials derived from the Get Britain Building and other housing-related funding announcements in GB, and that money has been allocated to support housing associations to provide new affordable homes through the co-ownership scheme and two new pilot schemes, the Affordable Home Loans Fund pilot and the Rent to Own scheme. So collectively these schemes are targeted at providing nearly 3,500 additional affordable homes across Northern Ireland.
Thank you. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Minister. Minister, what other funds have you explored to support social housing in Northern Ireland, in addition to the potential Barnett consequences? During your time as Minister, what efforts have you made to secure funds either for the Housing Executive by allowing them to go to the market and borrow, or by looking to others like housing associations to develop schemes like lots living above the shops?
Minister.
Well, there certainly has been in terms of the lot scheme, for example, a scheme that I think is successful and could have been brought back in, and certainly there was work that I had commissioned within the department to look at a revised type lot scheme that we would have been able to bring in. But from I've been in office, we were able to announce the significant investment from the European Investment Bank. We were able to announce significant investment from the Bank of Ireland. And again, there has been a clear demonstration that under my tenure, ambitious goals being set for new social homes to be built, evidenced in the programme for government, 9,600, and of course this year the monies that have been spent and the houses that are being built, and that has been something that under my watch that I've been pushing very hard at.
Thank you. Move on. I call Nicola Mallon.
Question number 5, Mr Deputy Speaker.
Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I'll take questions 5 and 6 together. The social sector size criteria is due to be introduced in Northern Ireland on the 20th of February. My officials have been preparing the necessary systems and processes to ensure no claimant in Northern Ireland suffers any negative financial impact as a consequence to the changes in how housing benefit is calculated. Urgent measures have been taken to ensure that the Department has the legal powers to mitigate the impact of the social sector size criteria. The necessary legislation was approved by the Assembly on the 16th of January. This legislation gives the Department the specific powers to make accurate and timely payments to the estimated 34,000 housing benefit claimants who may be impacted by the introduction of the social sector size criteria. This legislation sets out in detail all of the measures that my department will be taking to mitigate the social sector size criteria. Claimants who are eligible for a welfare supplementary payment will be paid 4 weeks in arrears, and the first payments will be made in the current financial year.
Nicola Mallon, supplementary.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for his questions thus far, and just to give recognition to the fact that under this mandate this will be his final appearance in question time, and to put on record my thanks for his help in some constituency matters in respect of housing. Minister, can I ask, given that Fresh Start was launched with much fanfare on the 17th of November 2015, given that the mitigation package in respect of the protections against the bedroom tax was heralded as one of the critical successful elements of that, why then the bringing forward of the regulations to protect people, why that was left so late? In fact, it was left just a few weeks before the introduction of the bedroom tax itself.
I think we have the question. Can we have the answer?
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and let me thank the member for her kind words in respect of my tenure as Minister, and I know that she has been a very strong advocate for her constituents and brought cases to me consistently in respect to their housing needs, and I'm sure that will be recognised. Obviously, the mitigation measures didn't just include the social sector size bedroom tax. There were a whole range of mitigation measures that we have had to introduce to mitigate the introduction of welfare reform into Northern Ireland, bedroom tax being one of them. And all of the plans to have them introduced were being run through according to a proper time frame. And in the normal course of the business of politics, there was no risk whatsoever of us not having in place the legislation to mitigate against this. And so that is why I was able to, ultimately, when we explored all of the options, I was able to lay down through the urgent route directly into this Assembly to get it done. Nobody could have legislated for the actions, obviously, that Sinn Féin took in respect of pulling down the executive. Of course, I'm relieved that we were able to find a way, and members supported me in that approach, to obviously mitigate so that the most vulnerable aren't impacted in respect of what has happened to this institution.
Thank you. I call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and thank you, Minister. Minister, the issue in front of us today is very reminiscent of the issue that's facing the Health Minister around waiting lists, in that a lot of the responses to these crises, as Nicholas mentioned, are very late in the day. Are you satisfied that in the 8 months that you've been the Communities Minister, that you've influenced the 9,600 bills, as you outlined there, that they will future-proof against this sort of thing happening again, so that there is different housing types across different tenures for the future, so that people will have the right sized houses to suit their needs?
Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Well, obviously, there was a very clear travel of direction that I had set, and the foundations have been laid in respect of the type of commitment to build to do with social housing, which would have been, over the course of the mandate, 5 years, a very challenging target to reach. But of course, housing is a real challenge for people in terms of building what we need, not just in terms of social housing, but of course in the private sector. And so there was a course of work that was being looked at in respect of how we would free up the housing executive to allow it to do the things that it does best, and also allow access to the private markets. Now, obviously, that will have to sit in abeyance, and the next executive in this Assembly will have to pick up where we are in respect of that. But in terms of meeting the challenges around the pressures around supply, again, there was a course of work that I had been undertaking with the private sector that I was going to be chairing a stakeholder group to identify all of the issues around that, because it isn't just to do with the actual building of the houses, it's identifying the availability of land, it's then navigating in some communities where they don't want to have houses built, and how do you go through all of that process, linking into the community planning. And certainly there's pieces of work there that I'm confident that a future minister will be able to pick up and develop, but that ultimately will be a matter for the next executive and this Assembly to deal with.
Thank you. I call Gordon Dunn.
Deputy Speaker, can the Minister outline how welfare supplementary payments are to be calculated?
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Well, welfare supplementary payments under the bedroom tax are calculated to offset the financial disadvantage the claimant incurs as a result of the application of the size criteria to their housing benefit entitlement. The amount of welfare supplementary payment a claimant received will be dependent on the claimant's housing benefit entitlement and their degree of under-occupation. Housing benefit claimants who are affected by the bedroom tax will see a reduction in their housing benefit component, calculated by a reduction of 14% of the total eligible rent for under-occupancy by one bedroom and 25% of the total eligible rent for under-occupancy by two or more bedrooms.
Thank you. We move on. I call Mr. Edwin Poots.
Seven.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The Community Halls Capital Grant Pilot Programme was launched on the 19th of October 2016 and it closed on the 23rd of November 2016 with 860 applications received, and following a robust, transparent and accountable assessment, up to 90 projects were selected for financial assistance in 2016-17. Providing this assistance to these applicants will result in expenditure of £1.9 million in the 2016-17 financial year.
Supplementary.
Thank the Minister for his reply and his hard work over the course of the last 8 months. In terms of this scheme, was it only for Orange Halls to apply? Because I noticed some of the media seemed to be sort of putting it out there that this was some sectarian scheme. Was it available to all the community? And maybe the Minister could tell us some of the organisations that maybe did benefit from this scheme.
Well, Deputy Speaker, the answer very clearly is absolutely not. In respect of this, the programme was open to all types of facilities with a hall that is used by the local community, and applications were received from church halls, GAA clubs, Masonic halls, community groups and many others, and this funding cannot be used to purchase sporting infrastructure such as nets or pitches, but sports clubs have applied for money to improve the fabric of their halls to benefit the local community. So this scheme very much was open to everybody to apply to, and the criteria that was used against it was the way in which successful applicants were determined.
Thank you. I call Colin McGrath.
Deputy Speaker, I ask this question of the Minister without any malice, but can he understand how the way that a number of the funding schemes within his department have rolled out, there is a perception from some within our community that the decisions are sectarian?
I think, Deputy Speaker, it's in the very point that the member raises. It's a perception when it's not actually grounded in fact. And whenever we look at the way in which the funding was allocated and in terms of the community halls, this was something that whenever I was out in the community, people were saying, we have a need, and applications were being put into a pilot scheme that I recognised would be very important to those groups. And so you have GAA benefiting from this, Ancient Order of Hibernian benefiting from this, parochial halls within the Catholic Church benefiting from this. So any suggestion whatsoever that this in any way had a sectarian agenda is completely false, and I as Minister had no role whatsoever in assessing any of the applications, and I only became aware of the successful applicants after they had been made aware of it.
Can the Minister give any explanation as to how it was that St Saviour's Church in Connor, in my constituency, received a letter advising them they had been successful under the Community Hall scheme, which brought them great joy, only to be followed by a telephone call from the department to say it was a mistake? Can that matter be most thoroughly investigated before church representatives and I meet his departmental officials tomorrow?
Well, that's the first that I've been made aware of the situation that the member has brought to my attention, and of course I would expect this to be thoroughly investigated as to how anyone could be informed of a successful application to then have that subsequently withdrawn. So obviously I'll want to find out the reasons for that.
I call William Humphrey.
Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer so far. Indeed, his answer indicates very clearly that this was a scheme which reached across the community, across the country. Can I say to the Minister that he will, I'm sure, be disappointed at the remarks made by the leader of the SDLP in describing this as a sectarian scheme? Can I congratulate the Minister on finding the extra money which allowed some halls in my constituency to get some funding? But can I also say, given the amount of interest and the amount of potential funding that is required to meet the demand that clearly was met across Northern Ireland in terms of applications, can the Minister recommend that such a scheme, given if there was ever a new executive established in Northern Ireland with a new government, that such a scheme would be something which he would recommend to his successor to put in place?
Okay, I have said it, Member, I counted at least four questions. The Minister is entitled only to answer one.
Well, Deputy Speaker, I think the fact that you had 860 applications heavily oversubscribed, we were able to support up to 90. is a demonstration of the need that exists. And when we look at the organisations that were successful, we have 17 churches, and then you have 27 community organisations, of which you couldn't describe any particular affiliation to, Kilcooley Women's Centre, for example, being one of them. And then you see other organisations that were successful around sports. You had a Scouts Club. This, to me, demonstrates that these are facilities that our community very much value, particularly in rural communities, where often the availability of halls is limited. And so it is the churches, it is Orange Halls, it is other community-based organisations that do have these facilities that want to make them available to everyone in the public to use. And I think that is something to be encouraged. And I would hope that in the future this is a scheme that would be able to be taken forward in the inclusive way that I was able to develop it.
Thank you. We move on. I call Mr. Gary Middleton.
Number 8, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Deputy Speaker, I'm keen to see the review of my department's arms-length bodies progressed quickly so that the delivery of services to the citizens of Northern Ireland can be as efficient and effective as possible. Consequently, I have put in place a small central team to take forward the first stage, focusing on two key themes: to explore the scope, to rationalise and consolidate the numbers and functions of our various ALBs, and to examine the opportunity to extend the use of shared services arrangements across the various bodies. I've written to my executive colleagues, the chairpersons and the chief executives of each arm's length body, and the relevant trade unions to advise them of the review and my intentions going forward. My officials have arranged meetings with the chairpersons and chief executives of the bodies to initiate early engagement and consultation, and will also be meeting with trade union representatives. A public consultation on the identified options for delivery is planned for the summer.
Thank you, Mr. Middleton.
Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for his answer. Can the Minister outline whether the current political situation will have much of an impact on this proposal that he wants to carry out, and can he give any indication of a time frame as to whether such a consultation can be completed?
Well, Deputy Speaker, obviously the work that I have commissioned has started, and that work will continue, and it ultimately again will be up to the next executive and this Assembly to deal with the outworkings of that review whenever the findings come through. But when we consider that this department alone has got 21 arm's length bodies, and that doesn't include the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, and that hasn't been part of the review, collectively there is a combined annual budget in the order of £78 million. I think it's only but prudent that this review is carried out to ensure that the services that we are ultimately delivering to the public are being delivered in the most efficient and effective way possible. That's the spirit in which this review has commenced, and obviously I would hope that in the future it will be something that can be developed upon.
Thank you. I call Robbie Butler.
Deputy Speaker, I thank the Minister for his answers and welcome the chance to bring this question in this final meeting in this mandate. Can the Minister give an update as to the future plans for Sport NI, given the recent disruption and controversies that affected the organisation?
Well, Deputy Speaker, in terms of the recommendations, of which there were a significant number of recommendations for Sport NI, this department had a team there that was helping to provide the support in terms of the administration and the way in which the organisation is being run. And I'm very pleased that my Permanent Secretary and Deputy Permanent Secretary have been able to give me that assurance that that work has enabled Sport NI to develop in a way that they can start pulling that additional support that the department has been putting into Sport NI. And I think that's a demonstration that it's an organisation that has turned a corner and will ultimately deliver what we all want, is that, and that is to the benefit of people that engage in sport and those sporting organisations.
We move on. I call Paula Bradley.
Deputy Speaker, question 9.
Deputy Speaker, this is an exciting year for women's sport, with the finals of the Women's Rugby World Cup and the finals of UEFA Women's Under 19 European Championships both being held this summer. Increasing female participation in sport and physical activity in Northern Ireland is a key priority for my department, and these tournaments can be used as a catalyst to drive that participation. One of the key targets with Sport Matters, the Northern Ireland Strategy for Sport and Physical Recreational 2009-2019, is to increase female participation rates. And while much work has already taken place to address this target, including work by Sport NI, local councils, sports governing bodies and sports organisations, I have been able to commit a further investment of £370,000 in the 2016-17 financial year to fund initiatives aimed at increasing female participation in sport. £250,000 of this money has been provided for Sport NI to work with the Female Sports Forum and a range of organisations to increase sporting opportunities for women and girls across the province as part of the Female Sports Forum strategy called Active, Fit and Sporting. A total of £120,000 has been provided to Ulster Rugby, the Irish Football Association and the Ulster Council GAA, with each organisation receiving £40,000 to take forward activities which aim to encourage increased participation by women and girls in sporting activities and to help build capacity in areas such as administration, officiating and coaching. All of this funding is in addition to the initiatives already being taken forward through Sport NI programmes such as Active Communities, Everybody Active 2020, Active Awards and Active Clubs, which have specific targets for female participation. These initiatives will all contribute towards increasing female participation rates in sport and physical activity.
Thank you. Can I say to Ms Bradley, unfortunately the Minister has talked you out of a supplementary. I can see disappointment etched all over your face. We now move on to topical questions. Mr McCrossan is not in his place. I call Mr Patrick McLoone.
Thanks very much indeed, Deputy Speaker. Could I ask the Minister, please, for an update on his proposals for Cookstown jobs and benefits and social security offices?
Well, Deputy Speaker, members will know that there was a consultation in respect of four offices, and there hasn't been recommendations brought to me in respect of the outworkings of that at this stage.
Mr McLoone.
For his answer. Could I ask the Minister what his own mind is in regard to the closure or the retention of those services and those facilities in the Cookstown area, which services a big rural capacity area?
Minister.
Well, obviously, Deputy Speaker, in the position that I have held now, I have always looked at seeing ways in which we can try and keep our offices open. And so whenever jobs were under threat in Armagh, in Oma, in Ballymena, I have sought to find ways in which we can keep those offices open and ways in which staff are able to be as close to home as possible. So, of course, in respect of the four that were being consulted upon, that is something that hasn't came to me at this stage. But obviously I'm always very reluctant to be taking decisions that would mean the withdrawal of staff from those locations. But I make the point that as services change, as they are changing through universal credit and the changes that come through that, it does require reconfiguration right across Northern Ireland in terms of how those services are being delivered. And that's something that the next executive is going to have to grapple with.
Thank you. I call George Robinson.
Speaker, can I ask the Minister for an update on the Portrush Regeneration Programme in my East Londonderry constituency?
Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Well, this has been a project that I went to meet with the people in Portrush Golf Club very early on. They sought a meeting with me. I met with them. They outlined the vision that they have to capitalise on the Open coming to Northern Ireland, a hugely prestigious golfing tournament with huge economic potential for Northern Ireland. And they set out how that could benefit this part of Northern Ireland, the region up with the Causeway and Coast Glens council area. And I could see very much the opportunity that exists. And that's why I continue to pursue this issue with executive colleagues and through the executive. And I was pleased that just before Christmas we were able to get executive agreement to the establishment of a working group, which I chaired the inaugural meeting off at a very high level to drive forward the regeneration project for Portrush. And as part of that, I was able to launch a £3 million urban development grant scheme, which is specific to Portrush, and it's envisaged that this scheme will help to unlock the vacant and underused properties in Portrush and provide long-term regeneration for the town. And applications to the department for this scheme are due by the 22nd of February. And in addition, my department had previously committed £500,000 to take forward the design and economic appraisal work for two key projects in the town, the Public Realm Scheme and the train station development. Designs for both these projects are now underway.
Mr. Robinson, supplementary.
Minister, for his answer, could I congratulate the Minister for championing the scheme? And how did the process take on board the views of the locals?
Minister.
Deputy Speaker, obviously the Council for the Causeway Coast and Glens area, they have set up a quarterly public consultation forum for people to come along and make their voices heard. The last meeting of this forum was at the start of January, and the next one is planned for the start of April. So obviously it's critically important that you get the input from local people in terms of how the town is being developed. But the executive has agreed in principle £17 million of investment into Portrush in advance of the open taking place. And this is a real opportunity to capitalise on that event and to present all that is good about Northern Ireland, because we really do have a jewel in the crown when it comes to our golfing potential that exists, the landscapes that we have, and with the open coming to Portrush, this is something that's too important to miss, and I'm very much pleased that there is now a very clear pathway to ensure that we maximise the potential that will come from it.
Thank you. I call Rosemary Barton. The member wishes us to move on. I call Mr. Steve Aiken.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Could the Minister outline what discussions he has had with NILGA and the local councils regarding his decision not to devolve regeneration powers to the councils?
Minister.
But Deputy Speaker, this is obviously an issue that has been raised some time ago. A decision was taken in respect of that around the regeneration powers with local government. That has been communicated to local government, and obviously it's important that we maximise the opportunities that exist in the powers that reside within this department and the way in which councils work to collaboratively work together. And as I have made the point, Northern Ireland is a small place. And if the public don't differentiate between local government and central government, they ultimately want to see action. And there is no reason why central government and local government cannot act collaboratively to maximise that. And I've just outlined in the previous answer to a question, Portrush, for example, that is a prime example of central government working with the local authority to deliver something that will be very special for that part of Northern Ireland.
Mr. Aiken,
thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed for the Minister for his words. However, since we're heading into a long period of suspension potentially, and given the current instability and uncertainty for the future of these institutions, would the Minister agree with me this makes his decision not to devolve the regeneration powers promised to the councils under the RPA even more absurd?
Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. No, we don't. I'm certainly not one that takes the pessimistic view. I believe that devolution is good for Northern Ireland, and I think all politicians should be going into this election in the mindset of wanting to make this place work, because that's ultimately what the people want. Yes, there's difficulties. Yes, there's challenges. That's, I think, an understatement. But nevertheless, I think it is what the people will expect of us. And therefore, I always take the view better to be hopeful as opposed to be negative. And I think we should go in to this election with the mindset of getting this place up and running on the other side of the election. And then we continue to deliver on the issues that affect all of our people, irrespective of what community that they come from. And if we take that approach, I think that ultimately will be what wins through on the other side of this election, and we tackle the big issues and we get on with delivering.
Thank you. I call Emma Little-Pengilly.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Minister, you will be aware of the very, very good work that many thousands of small community organisations do right across Northern Ireland. I know you've been very supportive of those, and you've been out to see very many of those. Those are the types of organisations with a significant number of volunteers, and they do apply, for example, to the small grants. I'm aware that there is a small capital grant scheme within your department at the moment. Can you give us some indication if there's any intention to have a further release of successful applicants from that this week?
Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Well, this was something that whenever I was out with the community groups, as the members have indicated, where a lot of these smaller organisations, the ability to raise the capital that is needed for very small equipment presents a very real challenge to them. And so there was a scheme that was announced and applications were made to it. And I hope to be in a position within the next 24 hours to be able to authorise those letters of offer to be sent out to those organisations that have been successful to the scheme.
Emma Pengelly.
I thank the Minister for that response. The Minister will be aware of some very good organisations, not least in my own constituency, for example, of Hannahdale and Haywood Association, the Balnify Community Organisation, and right across South Belfast we've got very many great organisations. Some of those organisations did apply into the capital grant scheme from your department, and unfortunately some weren't able to do that within the timescale. But can the Minister give some indication if there are plans within your department to reopen the scheme to application next year, because it was such a successful and much sought after scheme?
Minister.
Certainly I think the number of applications demonstrates the enthusiasm that exists, and I think that is a scheme that any minister would want to be taking forward, given the success that there has been and the demand that exists. But the small-scale capital equipment, it's a £300,000 budget that was identified, and we hope to be able to announce the successful applicants for that, which is again representative right across the community. But let me put it on the record once more. I was neither involved in the assessment of it, nor do I know who the successful applicants are. I will be advised of that whenever the groups are advised of it.
I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can the Minister give us an update on the Subregional Stadia programme, please?
Minister.
Well, in respect of that, again, that's an issue that has been on recently. The consultation analysis of that has been completed. And obviously, because of the circumstances that we now face, that is something that I would have been very keen to move on, and I'm talking to officials about that to see if there is any potential that we can push forward in this programme in the remaining days that there are for me to do that. But obviously, given what's happened, that has created challenges.
Sandra Overend, supplementary.
Thank you. And I thank the Minister for that. I wonder, is he enthusiastic that he'll be able to deliver that in the number of days that remain, given the fact that clubs have been waiting since last March, since the consultation process was ended, and announcement was promised before Christmas. How confident is the Minister that there will be something for local clubs?
Minister.
Well, what I would say is that the £36 million is ring-fenced money. That is there. The executive has already taken that decision. So this is money that is there, certainly not lost. And of course, we want to see that being announced in terms of the way in which it would be allocated to allow people to make applications to it. And that's something that I'm currently engaging with my officials on.
I call Joanne Bunting.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister for an update on the Northern Ireland Housing Executive's tower block strategy, please?
Minister.
Well, in respect to the tower block strategy, and this was touched on earlier in terms of the motion, this is entirely a matter for the Northern Ireland Housing Executive in respect to how they manage the properties that they have within their remit. The Northern Ireland Housing Executive Board has requested that their officers develop a comprehensive action plan for each tower block based on the options appraisal. And it is the intention to have these action plans submitted to the Northern Ireland Housing Executive Board by the late summer of this year. But I recognise that this is an issue for tenants in tower blocks and that they have been very much exercised about. And obviously the Housing Executive are dealing with that, and I would hope that they'll be able to expedite the matter so that people know what it is in terms of the plans for these tower blocks.
Thank you. Joanne Bunting, supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. But given the poor condition
of these tower blocks. I welcome that the Minister has said that the plans will be in place by late summer, but when does he anticipate action starting to, I suppose, take to get the remedial works underway in the blocks?
Minister.
Well, obviously, remedial work that needs to be carried out for tenants, that should be being carried out where the need is presented. But the Housing Executive, they have advised me that as part of its overarching asset management strategy for all its homes, that it undertook to include a dedicated strategy, and that strategy determined an option appraisal for all 32 tower blocks that need to be developed. That is now completed, and the initial position was presented to the Board for consideration at its meeting in November. This set out both the significant investment requirements for the tower blocks and the associated high management costs, which would not represent good value for money. And at the meeting, the Board agreed that the Housing Executive strategy, their long-term approach, should be to decommission all of the tower blocks. And the Board also agreed that action, as appropriate, would be taken to maintain all tower blocks to an acceptable standard until such time as they are to be decommissioned. The Housing Executive Board requested officers to develop a comprehensive action plan for each tower based on the options appraisal and to engage with tenants, communities and local political representatives to identify future solutions.
I call Mr Trevor Lunn. Very quick question.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister just reference the announced public realm scheme in Lisburn? Does he have an anticipated start date, and can he give us an assurance perhaps that disastrous experience of the last public realm scheme won't be repeated on this occasion.
Well,
as the member will know, it is the local council who ultimately tender and manage the project, as it was with the scheme that now I think demonstrates was the right thing to do. But of course, I, like he, was equally frustrated with the way in which it was developed and the problems that created. So this scheme, of course, is the linkage scheme to connect into all of that work that has been carried out, a 3.7 million scheme which the Council are putting a significant investment into. They ultimately will manage the outworkings of that project. But of course, I know that local businesses will want to know how it's going to be implemented. It is planned for the end of this year in respect of the works, but there will be engagement with local businesses in respect as to how that's going to be taken forward.
Thank you. Unfortunately, there's no further time for supplementary. There'll be a rush, I think, to the local press, but time is up. We now move on.